In Lesson 6.3, students see a demonstration in which two clear colorless liquids are added and a thick white solid is formed. So the question is, how do you know that when a solid is formed from two liquids that it's different than what was used to make the liquids? Is it different than the reactants? Did a chemical reaction really occur? So the big science concepts covered are, in a chemical reaction, the bonds between the atoms in the reactants are broken, the atoms are rearranged and rebonded to form the products, and the type and number of atoms in the reactants is equal to the type and number of atoms in the products, because mass is conserved, and a precipitate is formed when two solutions react and a solid forms which won't dissolve like the reactants dissolved to make the original solution. So it's something different. So a chemical reaction took place. So as a demonstration, you can combine a sodium carbonate solution with a magnesium sulfate solution and see what happens. And students will see that these are clear, colorless solutions. You can tell them what you use to make them and that a precipitate or a solid forms. And you could stir that up if you want and show students that it won't dissolve. Students are going to make two other solutions, one calcium chloride and the other sodium bicarbonate, and they're going to combine those. Let's see. And here, not only is a white solid formed, but a gas is also produced. If students look closely, they can see that the white substance formed as part of this reaction is a solid. They're tiny particles. It's not as clear as in the demonstration that you do with them, but if they look closely, they'll be able to see it. Now this reaction, the one that students do, you can show them the chemical equation for it. It's calcium chloride and sodium bicarbonate. If you react those, you get calcium carbonate, which is the white precipitate, sodium chloride, which is familiar to students, it's salt, water, and the gas that's produced is carbon dioxide. So on the student activity sheet, you can have students write down the different atoms, in this case calcium, chlorine, sodium, hydrogen, carbon, and oxygen, and write down the number of atoms on the reactant side and the number on the product side, and they should be equal. It's also a nice reaction because you can practice using subscripts to see, for instance, how many chlorine atoms there are, but you can also use coefficients to tell you that if you combine those with the subscripts, you're going to have, in this case, 6 oxygens. 3 oxygens here because of the subscript, but there's a coefficient 2 in front of the whole thing, which means that there's 2 of these molecules, so you have a total of 6 oxygens, and students can actually see there's 6 there. So it's a nice way to practice seeing that the equation is balanced. Now, students can filter the precipitate, and it's easy to do. You just take a brown paper towel and put it inside a tall cup, and then pour the white liquid in here, the result of the reaction that they did between the calcium chloride and the sodium bicarbonate solutions. And if you let that drip through, you'll end up with a white solid inside this brown paper towel. And then to confirm that it actually was a chemical reaction, you can put the brown paper towel out and let it dry. You can use a spoon or a popsicle stick to scrape it into a pile. Then you can ask students how you could determine whether this precipitate is different than the original reactants that you used, calcium chloride and sodium bicarbonate. One idea is to use a solubility test and put the same amount of the precipitate, calcium chloride, and sodium bicarbonate in cups, and then add the same amount of water to each one and swirl them to see the difference in dissolving, if there is any. And students will see that the calcium chloride dissolves, the sodium bicarbonate will dissolve, but the precipitate does not. So it must have been a chemical reaction. The precipitate is definitely something different than the reactants. If you're in an NGSS state, there are 2 performance expectations that apply to this lesson, MS-PS1-2 and MS-PS1-5. MS-PS1-2 says, analyze and interpret data on the properties of substances before and after the substances interact to determine if a chemical reaction has occurred. And MS-PS1-5 is develop and use a model to describe how the total number of atoms does not change in a chemical reaction and thus mass is conserved. Well, lesson 6.3 works for both of these performance expectations since students look at the solubility of the reactants before they interacted and after in the form of a precipitate to see if they're the same or different, and they determine that they're different and therefore a chemical reaction occurred. And students also look at the equation for the chemical reaction, and they see that the type and number of atoms in the reactants equals the type and number of atoms in the products, and thus mass is conserved. If you look at the foundation boxes, students develop a model to describe unobservable mechanisms. They look at the chemical equation, and they use that as a model to see what must have happened in the chemical reaction. As far as disciplinary core ideas, students see that substances react in characteristic ways, and that the atoms that make up the original substances are regrouped into different molecules, and these have different properties. That's shown when they test the solubility of the products, the precipitate, and show that it's different than either of the reactants. And as far as cross-cutting concepts, matter is conserved because atoms are conserved in physical and chemical processes. In this case, it's shown in a chemical process. So good luck with the lesson, and thanks for watching.